Fourth Estate presents New Voices, the Guardian Fourth Estate BAME Short Story Prize 2018. Written and read by Savannah Burney, Jason Deelchand, Yiming Ma, Varaidzo, Kit Fan, and Gurnaik Johal.
Swimmer of Yangtze by Yiming Ma. The boy had been born with four healthy limbs, but by the end of his first year, he had already lost both his arms. Broad-toned shoulders gave him the triangular physique that so many young men craved, as if his upper body were perfectly fitted for a Zhongshan tunic suit, although if he were actually to have worn one, his father would have needed to trim both sleeves off so as to draw less attention to his son's missing limbs beneath blue and black cloth. Both his parents had worked as tailors in our humble village near Wuhan, as their own forefathers had done. They had been born during the glorious years of the Long March and the rise of our Communist Party. Recently, they had enjoyed the fortune of watching our leader, Chairman Mao, dive into the Yangtze River to swim against the great wind and great waves of the bourgeoisie. Oh, how lucky we all had been to witness the launch of our Cultural Revolution. Only 2 days after the swim, Chairman Mao, may he live for 10,000 years, returned to the Great Hall of the People in Beijing to arrest that traitor Liu Xiaoqi, who died a mere 3 years later after a too few number of public beatings at party denouncement meetings. As a baby, the swimmer had been ordinary. He cried as all boys do while they get used to empty stomachs. He was skinny, but not overly malnourished. Almost daily, he had been breastfed by his mother until she fell sick from some evil curse, which the doctors had called pneumonia and would later sour her milk. For the next year, his father would stitch an extra Zhongshan suit each week to afford the extra cost of cow milk for his only son. Soon, the rumor would spread all over the village near Wuhan that the swimmer's mother could no longer give birth, for why else would the tailor not have compelled his wife to try again after her illness for another child, one not so accursed? Still, the story of how the boy lost his arms remains a mystery. Some whisper that it was caused by some fungus stemming from the baby's long baths in the Yangtze, since the tailor's shop near the river had also served as their family's sleeping quarters. Others say his disease was genetic, but to those gossipers I ask, why did his ailment affect only his arms and not the rest of his body? All we know for certain is that when the boy was barely 8 months old, and he is truly blessed by the Holy Buddha that he was too young to remember this, his parents took him to Wuhan Children's Hospital one evening, and when they returned, their child no longer had arms. Later, the rumor flooded our village that the father had locked himself inside his workshop for 3 straight days after returning from the hospital, all so that he could sew a new set of clothes for his boy, none of which bore a single sleeve. Surely his mother must have been devastated. First, her son had lost his arms, but then her pneumonia, which had already cost her family a fortune in cow milk, began to give her such severe headaches that she could no longer help her husband with his tailor shop. And of course, this only tightened money matters more. So what to do with a boy with no arms? Sure, he did not need to flip over the pages of old texts written by Li Bai or Du Fu, but also, he did not have any hands to feel the fine wrinkles in a piece of fabric or operate a sewing machine. Who would inherit his family's shop? Many in the village wondered about this. They would gossip over bowls of beef noodles, making bets about when the tailor might sell his shop on the cheap. I, of course, did none of this, and flashed evil eyes when I heard them whisper about the tailor and his armless son. Until news spread to my door one night that the tailor's wife, bedridden once more, had breathed her last, and that not even I had any choice but to ponder such business matters. The next morning, a few from our village saw his little body in the Yangtze, thrashing up against the current while kicking like a river dolphin in the water. And we had thought every Baiji in the Yangtze had already passed away. Once, I saw him practicing in the river. It was on a clear day, though this did not matter given the Yangtze's murky nature. I was rushing from the market to see his father about a tear in my wife's blouse when suddenly I noticed the armless boy surging across the river. Lying on his back, his small body undulated as if he were a wave himself. At each crest, he lifted his head to take in new gulps of air as if gasping for life before sinking back beneath the water. At first, I feared that the boy was drowning. But then, as I watched him, I became transfixed by the smoothness of his rhythmic motion, his body moving effortlessly through the river like a long muscle. Perhaps it was only the sun playing tricks with these old eyes, but in the bubbles formed by the water his body displaced, I began to imagine sinewy arms extending from his shoulders. So graceful and natural were the movements of his body in the Yangtze. Tell me, old man, that boy in the river, he's not one of this village, is he? A booming voice cut across my thoughts. I turned to see a stranger. He stood leaning slightly toward the river, painting the first Wuhan Yangtze bridge, spreading dabbles of color upon white paper, while continuing his musing. Rather, he swims as if he belongs to the water itself. What rudeness from this man to interrupt my silence! And he was not even from our village. Yes, he is the son of my tailor, and he has no arms, I said. You would do better to paint him instead. Really? Is that right? The visitor said. He stared at the swimmer floating in the river. He must have such strong legs. Yes, this was true. But later, when I spoke with the tailor, he boasted that the secret lay not with his son's legs, but rather his feet. It was this extraordinary skill with his toes which allowed the boy to brush his teeth, and even pick up chopsticks to enjoy his favorite dishes of steamed wuchang fish, or so the tailor told me. Why does he swim so often? I asked the boy's father too, after I arrived at his tailor shop. He replied that he did not know, but when the newspapers began to write about his son, he suddenly announced the reason. For the communist government and our great chairman Mao Zedong. Those words were quoted in his name and printed in the Changjiang Daily Press. Boy with no arms swims across the Yangtze, that first headline read. Soon, reporters from other cities in Hubei province were traveling to Wuhan too to write about the swimmer. And one day, I even heard that a famous reporter from Xinhua Beijing had come to our train station. So much attention bestowed upon our humble village. Not since the grace of our chairman's swim in the Yangtze had we enjoyed such attention. From morning to dusk, reporters would crowd along the edge of the river to take photographs of the swimmer practicing his dolphin kicks in the cloudy water. At the beginning of this commotion, a few local boys, no doubt among them the no-good sons of four-eyed Afong and shiny-head Lao Chen, followed the swimmer into the river in hopes of being photographed too. Barely 1 week passed before those local boys gave up their foolish ambitions, as stories of the armless swimmer continued printing in every paper while their own faces remained unseen. Soon, the tailor's son returned to being the only swimmer in the Yangtze. You are so lucky, every villager of Wuhan told the father, and indeed before long, he became known as the most famous tailor in all of Hubei. Sometimes, he would even reject business. My son is the swimmer of Yangtze, the tailor would say, if he were tired. And because of this reputation, nobody he rejected ever acted upset. Then one morning, I was eating a bowl of beef la mian at four-eyed Afong's noodle stand, when suddenly a great herd of running villagers spread news to our table that the swimmer had gone missing. Immediately, I released the chopsticks from my hand and rose from my wooden stool to look for four-eyed Afong and tell him that I would return to finish my noodles later. But already, the no-good noodle stall operator had gone to the river to see for his own eyes. And behold, in the Yangtze, there was no swimmer. What has befallen the swimmer of Yangtze? Everyone cried, circling the riverbank. More quietly, they asked, how would this impact business? For months, our stalls had been surging with profits because of tourists traveling from all over the country to see the swimmer. And now we were afraid, for many of us had already expanded our shops to accommodate this traffic. All is well, a voice suddenly called out. From the riverbank, the familiar shape of a middle-aged man began walking towards our panicked crowd. And indeed, I knew I recognized his shadow. It was a tailor. "Where is your son, the swimmer of Yangtze? Is he ill?" Four-Eyed Da Feng asked. "Has he been kidnapped by some enemy of our village? Will he be back swimming soon?" Shiny Head Lao Chen followed. A rumbling laugh exploded from the tailor, a sound I had never heard from him before in my many years visiting his shop. "My son, the swimmer of Yangtze, is healthy and well, but he is not in Wuhan anymore, because the great Communist Party, led by our leader Chairman Mao, has summoned him to Beijing to swim for our People's Republic." At first, I was too shocked to speak. Would our great Communist Party, only 20 years after its heroic liberation of our country through heavy arms and fearless patriotism, truly call upon a boy with a history of neither? Even if that were true, in one day, would they make him disappear from our village? Not possible. But then, as the tailor began to explain how Red Army comrades had arrived last night at his shop bearing important documents from Beijing, we suddenly noticed the brown sheet between his fingers. And after Four-Eyed Da Feng swung his arms around to snatch that paper from the tailor's soft hands, that no-good noodle store operator unfurled the letter in the air for all of us to see. And indeed, there upon the brown paper was the signature of our Chairman Mao himself. Oh, what glorious pride I felt overflowing my chest. "Will he be swimming for the International Games?" I asked. "Yes," the tailor said. "But apparently, he would swim in the competition for swimmers with disabilities, which also happened every 4 years, and this made us no less proud." By the river that day, we showered the tailor with congratulations. And the next morning, when I brought over some meat and rice rations for the tailor, I saw a mountain of gifts piled up on the ground outside his shop, like an offering to the Holy Buddha himself. Home of the great swimmer of Yangtze, the tailor had stitched onto a long piece of fabric, which he fastened onto his front door. And soon, even the mayor of Wuhan traveled down to the riverbank to meet the tailor and commission him to sew those same words upon a banner to be strung between the twin red pillars of the city's Dragon Gate, so that all who walked underneath would know our village's great honor. 3 nights later, when the mayor hoisted the banner high between the twin dragons, all of Wuhan erupted with the sound of firecrackers. In the summer of 1976, with business booming in our village beside Wuhan, Shiny Head Lao Chen bought the first television in town. He had timed this purchase perfectly so that he could show off his electric box during the international games he knew we all wanted to watch. "We will witness our great hero, the swimmer of Yangtze, win as a village," he shouted, pointing at his small television. He had set it up outside his house in the town square near the Red Dragon Gate, and we cheered his generosity as if the selfless spirit of Lei Feng had been reborn. On the eve of the swim, even the tailor came from the riverbank to watch. Shiny Head Lao Chen offered him the best chair in front of the television while the rest of us crowded around, elbowing one another for a better view of the black and white screen. Then, after too many hours of watching other competitions, for apparently those without limbs competed at many sports, we finally saw our hero in the pool. He was the only Chinese. In the water, our swimmer jumped up and down, nodding his head vigorously at the crowd of foreigners, for of course he had no arms with which to wave and earn their cheers. But in our village, and almost certainly all of Wuhan, we were shouting for only one swimmer, and that was the swimmer of Yangtze. As the race looked to start, our hero placed both feet against the wall and turned his back towards the other end of the pool. Ah, so he would be swimming backstroke. Pressed up to near standing while facing the wall, the swimmer held himself frozen in the air, clenching between his teeth a white towel held out by his Chinese coach, who knelt upon the deck and stared at the boy's eyes. "Go, swimmer of Yangtze. I was so nervous that my arthritic hands began to cramp, but I did not mind." Then we heard the gunshot, and the swimmer was off, pulsing through the water. "Add oil, swimmer of Yangtze," we cheered. There, on the flickering black and white screen, were the dolphin kicks we had seen him practice in the river. Then, at the end of the wall, we saw him flip underwater and begin those kicks again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.